You've never given me that kind of applause when I say it. I love begging for whatever I can get. My name is Rod Bigelow. I'm Executive Director and Chief Diversity and Inclusion Officer at Crystal Bridges, and I'm so glad to welcome you here to the Great Hall in wonderful Bentonville tonight. Thank you for coming. You're excited, right? Before we begin our conversation, I want to begin with our Indigenous Peoples acknowledgement. As Crystal Bridges in the Momentary, we recognize our roles as settlers and guests in Northwest Arkansas region. We acknowledge the Caddo, Quapaw, and Osage, as well as the many Indigenous... We acknowledge the Caddo, Quapaw, and Osage, as well as the many Indigenous caretakers of this land and water. We appreciate the enduring influence of the vibrant, diverse, and contemporary cultures of Indigenous peoples, and we are conscious of the role in colonizations that museums have played. As cultural institutions, we hold ourselves, we have a responsibility to engage in the dismantling of historical and systemic invisibility of Indigenous peoples, past, present, and future. We choose to intentionally hold ourselves accountable to appropriate conversations, representation, connection, and education to facilitate a space of measurable change. Thank you. So you are all here because Annie Leibovitz is a legendary artist, and I'm absolutely enamored about this exhibition. We just had the opportunity to walk through with Annie, and I'm still sort of gushing that you're here. It kind of freaks me out, but it's amazing. The exhibition features hundreds of Annie's iconic portraits, including a set of portraits that images that were made just for Crystal Bridges. So that's pretty cool. Vogue magazine called this exhibition groundbreaking, and I couldn't think of a better word to describe it. Thank you, Annie, for being part of it. And thank you to our members and sponsors. You are our support system here at Crystal Bridges. We couldn't do anything that we do without your support. Could you all raise your hands if you are members of the museum? All right, give yourselves a hand. And here's my pitch, if you're not a member, tonight is the night to join. This is my formal invitation. You'll get great opportunities to get early peeks at museum activities, exhibitions, and the opportunity to be the first to meet folks like Annie Leibovitz. Okay, it's time to introduce the people you actually came to hear, not me. So first, our acting curator of contemporary art, Alejo Benedetti, who coordinated this exhibition at Crystal Bridges. Alejo, if you know him, he is the most mild-mannered gentleman that has this brilliant soul about him. So thank you. He has worked tirelessly to have this come together and has been a great member. I think he's practically a member of your team now, but you can't have him. And Alejo is in conversation today with the incomparable Annie Leibovitz. So I'm gonna get off the stage. Annie, I'm not gonna introduce you because the conversation is gonna be incredible, and you need no introduction, so have at it. Enjoy.
All right, no curveballs.
Okay.
Okay. It's good. It's just, it's you, it's me, and a couple of our friends. One or two. So first off, we have to start by thanking you for your vision, For folks who have been through the show, you already know that this is incredible. For folks who have not been through yet, you're in for such a treat. This is really a powerful exhibition. It's an intimate exhibition, and it is one that fully puts Annie's brilliance on display. And so we're gonna chat about that a little bit. But I think maybe the best place to start in talking about this exhibition is how this whole idea and this whole exhibition started. How did it come into being?
So, you know, I think thank you is really to all of you and this museum.
Actually, if you wanna.
Okay. I think the thank you really is due all of you and this museum. And, you know, when I came out to Bentonville to photograph Alice Walton, you know, I walked the museum and walked the grounds and went through the permanent collection but I couldn't, it was just so beautiful to see the gaggle of young children running through the museum and the classrooms and the liveliness of people who were here, you know, who came to look at the work. And I think you have to. I'm so impressed with that, and very moved by it, and find that in this day and age of museums, that you guys are doing the right stuff. I mean, it's just really, you know, it's so impressive. So that really had a very strong, very strong thing happened to me with that. And so it was interesting because, you know, I photographed Alice, and she was definitely a hoot. I mean, she definitely, like, I couldn't keep up with her. And, you know, I ended up, you know, because she moved from Texas, and she ended up, as you all know, you know her probably pretty well, and she moved into the family house, and it, but it turns out that her real love is out on the lake and driving those boats, you know. So, and she loves jumping in the water. You know, it's 12 degrees. She loves swimming almost every day, you know, in that water. The portrait that we ended up running in the screens is really of her in the house, because I don't think you see Alice that reflective very often, you know, like, you know, in, you know, sort of into herself a bit, you know, in her family house. And, you know, of course, what she did is so remarkable to give this to us, you know, and I, you know. So she asked me about doing a show, and I said, you know, I don't really want a show, but I would love if you, you know, thinking of, you know, when Michelangelo was commissioned by the church, I guess, or something, you know, like, you know, if there was some way, you know, in those days, in that day and ages, if there was some way that she would commission for me to do more work. And it's hard right now with, you know, the magazines and, you know, to get the portraits that, you know, to keep up with the portraits I'd like to do, because the assignments are pegged to, you know, a movie coming out or something. And although I do think I get a lot of leeway with someone like Anna Winter, you know, with Condé Nast, but they, you know, I do love my work, and I didn't get it really. I just would love to do more, and you know, Alice said yes. You know, she said yes, and. And then we set about, you know, trying to nail everyone down. You know, that, you know, the lists were all over the place, and then it, you know, I don't know what it was like right after COVID, but it was hard to pin people down. You'll see, it's a funny story about Elon Musk, who had agreed to being photographed, and you know, he actually called Karen Mulligan in my studio in my office and said, well, what does Annie have in mind? And then we were trying to just pin down a date, and we couldn't really reach him. I mean, we couldn't really get him to, you know, to nail him down. And then Karen knew someone who knew his mother. So we called. It's true. We called his mother, and he was there the next day. It's actually true. So Mae Musk is in the show as well. So she's a formidable woman. She's amazing. She's amazing. And he's kind of a really fascinating, interesting man, for sure.
And so one of the things that is great is that photo of Elon Musk and his mom. And in fact, all of the new photos are presented on these massive screens, and they are absolutely mesmerizing. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit about why you chose to present the work on those screens.
Well, I've been working with screens a little bit. It started, we were touring some sort of an updated version of the women's project that I did with Susan Sontag in the late 80s, early 90s. And we started to add a screen or two, but nothing moved on the screens. There was like one image, or like two or three photographs that were large, and they were quite beautiful. So I always wanted to try this, and it's still like a work in progress. We're still, still figuring it out. But, digital looks good on a screen, and the digital photographs. Because there's light, coming from behind, and then I was sort of mesmerized. A lot of my photographs are complicated, and I have to tell you, I was spellbound to see them so big, and see into them, and see them more, the color more beautifully represented. I'm not a technical photographer, really. It's more about content. Like, that's more important than technique. But it fascinated me. And I also thought there was like this added bonus, since we were shooting right up into the to the end. And in fact, you need to know, we're going to be adding three or four more shoots to the screens. What I loved about it is you could add them. You didn't have to print them. You could just go ahead and slug them right in. So that seems like a really a benefit from working on the screens. But we haven't. I've been getting a little bit of whiplash, turning around trying to see some of the screens. But and then the timing of how long they should be on the screens. I mean, we literally were pulled out of the. I mean, my team and I worked on the screens for almost 7 days, straight. And it took really some time to understand. I've never done this before, like what the timing and how long they should be up. Megan Steinman, my niece, who, have worked a great deal in the art world, she walked through and she said, maybe you should get some pillows or some cushions or something to like designate where people should really be to watch this. So we've been talking about getting a rug, or especially when the younger classrooms start coming through, it might be nice.
Well,
and also the timing is down to, it's like 20 minutes, and I think it. I don't know if any human being can sit through 20 minutes.
I can think of probably a room full of people who would be happy to. But. But I love that you brought up when young people walk through, because one of the things that you have talked about.
So yes, when I built the show, when I thought about doing the show, it's really an installation. I really built the first two rooms that had history of sort of aha moments in my early work, and then it goes into a kind of potpourri of all this work. From over the years after that, and then it goes into the screens. But it's really built as a classroom for young people interested, or anyone interested in photography, to see what goes into the making of this work, and how each of these little scenarios build the work into what it is today. And I'm lucky to have had, over 50 years doing this, so it's kind of interesting to be able to look back. And so it's a classroom. And, I don't know if you know this, but we're bringing in, we got a really wonderful response from students, and I think we're bringing in, over 1,000 tomorrow
Yes.
In three yeah. groups. And we're going to walk them through, and I'll walk them through and talk you know about the work with them and really spend a lengthy question and answer session. Also, we built a reading room there, and we brought in like over 100 photography books, visual books, for anyone to sit in there and look at photography books, because I grew up and learned so much. I stand on the shoulders of so many great photographers because I love photography and I'm a big fan of photography and you know, looking, you know, Diane Arbus and Richard Avedon and, you know, Nadar, you know, Helmut Newton. I mean, it just goes on and on and on. Sally Mann. I mean, I love photography. So, the room is filled with those books, so for any young, anyone to stop and have a smoke and not really have a drink, you know.
Okay. One of the things that I think is very interesting in this show is that so much of you comes through, and I know that you and I share a common interest, and that is a fascination with outer space. And you talked about Elon Musk, but I wonder if you could talk about some of that a little bit more.
No, it's interesting. When I was young and working at Rolling Stone, I mean, I just always had a camera on me, and I was shooting all the time, and everything in front of me, and everything was interesting, and I just. It was amazing, and I was and I thought I was a photojournalist, and you know, I loved Life magazine, the photo stories, Eugene Smith, you know, I mean, all that was so powerful, the photo story, and so I really thought that's what I was, and I tried to do that, but it was tough because I realized I had a point of view, and I didn't, you know, strictly as a journalist, you stay objective, you stay outside, and you see things. And in war and in, you know, photojournalism today is like the strongest photography I see. When I look at the New York Times, and we actually are doing Lindsay Goddario for this, and she's in she's still in the Ukraine right now, so I'm waiting for her to come back from there so we can go onto the borders to shoot with her. But in any case, where was I? What I was trying to say is that, so I learned that at a certain point I had a point of view. And I found myself shifting over, especially as I started to do the conceptual work, which was a little bit of storytelling. I found that I wasn't a journalist, and then I found that this label of portrait photographer really allows you to be conceptual with a nod to journalism, and you know, I sort of found myself, you know, heading there. But yes, you're bringing up something else, which is that I do go on tangents. I mean, you can't. When I was working on Pilgrimage, you know, I would clear a room, you know, pretty fast, you know, because I would start talking about Abraham Lincoln and the Civil War. It was like, no, because I became so fascinated with it. What happened is I went to go see to photograph Michael Heiser at the City, and it was such. Karen Mulligan called me and said, you can go out to the City now, Michael's gonna go out there, and I was in India. And, you know, but we came back, it was like, you know, we did, you know, he's not well, so we just literally came back from India and jumped on a plane and went out there and spent 2 days out there in Nevada, you know, photographing him and the City. But I sort of, do you know about the City? Have you? I mean, his sculpture, his earthwork that takes up a mile long in the desert. And anyway, I began to sort of think it was a landing strip for aliens. You know, was 100% sure, but But it's an incredible work that he's been working on for 50 years. And it reminded me, because I had worked with James Turrell at the Roden Crater, and I had photographed Robert Smithson's Spiral Jetty, and there was this kind of like, it's this moment where there's this reach to the sky or the heaven or above us, or maybe it's my age, I'm just beginning to think of heaven. I don't know. But, so I became interested in space, and you know, we definitely asked if the astronauts would be available for us. That's a good story, actually, because, anyway. So we would have had to photograph.
Oh, we're gonna get there.
No. My assistants had already headed down to Houston, and I was headed to the plane, and we got a call that said the astronauts couldn't find their orange uniforms. You know, they said they were out to, they were the dry cleaners, or I don't know, they were something. And it was this true story. It's actually a true story. So we were stopped midstream, but we finally got down there. It was an amazing session with them, because they are really, if you get a chance, look at their faces. Who would want to be an astronaut? I don't know. But, I mean, it's such a brave thing, and they are so incredible. The woman, Christine, the engineer, as a set of four people, that their face, to me, I came back from that shoot, like it was the face of humanity to see their faces. They're just incredible people. So what were we talking about?
No, that's where we were headed, yeah. I do want to know, because I heard a rumor, and I'd like you to confirm it for us, you often ask the folks that you're photographing what music they would like to listen to.
That's true, yeah. So that is actually true. You have to understand, it was Houston, it was like 100 and something degrees, they're wearing those orange suits, you know, out in, you know, and the wind is blowing, like, thank God, but it was still, like, very hot, and, we asked them, you know, not if they could hear it, but we said, would you like to hear some music, you know, and they all agreed unanimously on Taylor Swift.
Which... if we needed any further proof that she is a big deal, she will also be
a... These guys have to live in a tin can for, you know. But, and I asked Reed, the commander, have you taken your daughters yet to see, you know, Taylor Swift? And, he said, I can't afford the tickets. So we immediately, you know, we got back to New York and we made a call to Taylor Swift's people and said, do something, you know, and they are. So, you know, I don't know. Oh yeah. Yeah, you should have some questions, yeah?
Yeah, so we know that
unless
y'all...
Unless you want to get into Abraham Lincoln and the...
I mean, we could also do that, but I know that there were many folks that wanted the opportunity to ask questions, so we are going to open it up now. Please raise your hand. No shrinking daisies. This is your chance to talk to Annie Leibovitz. Okay.
I'll be around the show afterwards, too, if you're too shy. Awesome. Understandable.
So we are going to grab a microphone, and I think perhaps this person right here, raising.
Oh, let me
hang
grab
on
you
just
the
a
mic.
Second to get this microphone.
I might have to translate because I'm.
I'll do my best.
I'm wearing hearing aids now. It's anyway. The Rolling Stones did it. It's like. Actually. It was really the Who. I remember the music going right through my body.
I am a retired educator, and I'm just curious about any educators in your early formative years that led you to art, to photography, to the field where you are now.
You know, I have to give a lot of credit to my mother, who was... sort of an extraordinary woman who you know, was a dancer, modern dance, was taught dance, Martha Graham in New York City, and, you know, always believed strongly in, you know, she, in culture, so to speak. I mean, my father was in the military and we traveled, so she managed to really encourage us as far as art and, you know, all facets of and reading, and she would take us to the library and just, you know, we would sit there. But I ended up going to the San Francisco Art Institute, and which is, you know, I went there really because their catalog had a picture of the bay, the San Francisco Bay. I thought it was so amazing looking. And I wanted to be an art teacher, and because I thought that was good. You could paint, and then you would teach, and you would have a living. And then I was told in the first semester by the head of the school, you know, basically that, you know, you couldn't teach art unless you were an artist. You know, you really needed. It was more to it than that. So anyway, it was, I'm really gonna have to work. You know, I changed. I changed majors. I think it was what I'm trying to get to is when I got involved in the photography program at the San Francisco Art Institute. They introduced me to Robert Frank and Cartier-Bresson, and it was really the work I emulated for 2 or 3 years. You know, the full frame. If you go through any of my work, if you look through the show, you'll see that you'll see the black line on the outside. That's the rectangle. I'm using the full imagery inside the camera, the full frame to shoot with and compose with. So that really set the standard for me. And I loved working in the world of magazines because they were great vehicles for photographing. It was part of the reason I wanted to. And I grew up in Rolling Stone and really learned about how to take pictures. And but I have to go back to that basic foundation of the painting and the learning about personal reportage from Robert Frank and Cartier-Bresson.
Excellent.
I didn't answer your question.
Can you describe for us what it was like to photograph the Queen?
Could you say that again? So sorry.
Could you describe for us what it was like to photograph the Queen?
To photograph the Queen.
Oh, the Queen. Oh, I loved it. It was like
you've heard of her.
We know. How many hours do we have? because I was really so it was so amazing because not only did I photograph her once, but we had the opportunity to photograph her twice, and the first time, you know, I thought I would never be seeing her again, and you know they really gave us all the catalogs of her clothing and her jewelry and her crowns, tiaras, and we, you know, basically could dress her, you know, however you wanted. I mean, if you look back at the work on the artists who've been allowed to, given that opportunity to take her photograph or paint her, she totally becomes the subject and totally gives herself over to you in reference to you. And if you think about Lucian Freud's painting, and she liked that painting, by the way. There was a big hullabaloo around the first shooting, this first sitting, because apparently the cape I had picked was like 75 pounds or something. And I think we interrupted her during her favorite daytime television program. And so she came down the hallway, like stomping down the hallway, furious. She said, I'm never wearing this again, you know. Like, so, you know, but she walked into the sitting, you walked into the rooms, and it had a little extra story to it because the BBC was filming a year in her life, and they went ahead and used that footage to say that she stomped out of the shoot. And it was quite the contrary. By the end of the shoot, you know, we had like a half hour or 40 minutes. You know, she totally settled in, and you know, we took our photographs, and I showed her a couple of ideas, and it was really great. So, you know, I came out of that shoot thinking, oh my God, she's really feisty. We have a live one here, you know. So, which is really true. She was. There was one moment, it was very poignant, now that she's no longer with us. I have talked about this once, but where she said, you would have liked to have photographed my my sister, you know, Margaret, you know. You know, because she, I think, you know, she just had a moment of, you know. So we went back the second time, and I had the opportunity to just, you know, I really wanted to photograph her not so laden with heavy things, but she there was, I'll tell you one other thing, I was trying to talk to her about, I didn't know what to talk to her about, but I was talking to her about photography and you know, how I said that I admired Cecil Beaton and the work he had done, and I was kind of modeling what we were doing a little bit on that, and she said, I'm sorry, you have to find your own way. You know? And it's like, you know, I think about that now, actually, and she was right. You know, especially as you finally get to this age where you, you know, having, you know, looked at so many other photographers and really admired them so much, I can't believe it. I need to find my own way. You know? She was right. Anyway.
That's great.
Do we have another question?
Oh. Yes, Annie, yeah, thanks so much for joining us.
You need to know she's the most photographed person in the world. You know, when you started to do research on her, you just saw how she'd been photographed. You know, it was kind of amazing. It was kind of overwhelming, you know, really.
You talked about having a point of view, which I loved, and full frame. And building that composition. Can you walk us a little bit through the process of what you have learned from maybe do's and don'ts and building that remarkable compositions, you know, you create?
It's kind of built in at this point. I mean, I'm framing right now. I mean, it's so many years of doing it that it's, I mean, along the way, like David Hockney, like, I remember when I saw his work come out, when he built those collages of pictures, I just got weak in the knees because I just thought, here I am, I'm limited to this camera where everything goes inside this like rectangle or this square, and he is like looking at things and they look how you see things. And I remember just, you know, being frustrated with the whole, you know, like keeping everything within the frame. I don't know. It's constant. I mean, the composition. Definitely, I learned from Cartier-Bresson and Robert Frank. You know, like looking at their work and, you know, how to frame and how to move things within the rectangle. I mean, you know, I worked on Matthew Humery. Are you here? Summer?
Yeah, he's here.
I worked on this. I was asked to. Matthew Humery did this wonderful show. He took the masterworks of Cartier-Bresson, and he asked, you know, five or six people to curate. You know, go through the work and pick whatever you wanted. You know, and then he put those five curators together as a show. You know, from the masterwork, there were about 350 photographs and. It was so fascinating to look at the compositions in Cartier-Bresson's work and him you know, working on the foreground, the middle, and the background.
Can you hear me? Do you know a Manhattan photographer named Jan Cobb?
Could you say the name again?
Jan Cobb.
Jan Cobb?
C-O-B-B?
Photographer.
Yeah, C-O-B-B, I think.
Jan Cobb.
I mean, it sounds really familiar. What work was... What, are they right there?
That would be pretty cool, yeah.
He is famous for taking pictures of some boxers and some famous people. I think he's on the upper 85th Street in Manhattan. He's done some real work.
Are they black and white?
Me and my brothers have breakfast. We have donuts with them every Monday morning.
Love that. I also love, we're gonna look him up.
We're gonna definitely gonna look him up.
Yeah. I also love all of these suggestions of artists that, you know, the best thing about art and about artists is that they just keep making more. You're never gonna run out. They just keep making more. You're never gonna run out of artists, so. Do we have another question? I have a few different hands. Where's the microphone?
Hi.
Here we go.
Hi, Annie. My name is Tina. I'm right here.
Oh, okay.
Hi. Hi. You're my biggest idol, so I'm kind of losing it. So I wrote it all down so I don't get too excited about seeing you. I'm having a hard time choosing one question. I'm an aspiring photographer myself, a former photojournalist. You said before that your photography isn't technical, which I thought was a really interesting way to say that, because when I look at it, it feels incredibly technical. And so I would like to know what that means, and then my second part is, what's your favorite photograph and why?
The second question was, favorite photograph and why?
Okay. I think it was because the Art Institute, I just remember, they didn't teach you much technically, and I remember, using the camera, and I had a Minolta SRT-101. I would line up the little needle inside to the thing, for the exposure, and I don't think I ever caught up again, But I really, photographed in black and white for so long before I went to color that I kind of knew black and white very, very well. I knew that, being inside, being outside, there were a few exposures, and I would just open up the camera. So I say I'm not technical because I guess it's not important to me on some level. And now at this point, it's I don't even know how to use these cameras, actually. I have to turn to Mateus, my assistant, and said, how, because they're computers. They really are computers. And I have three of them. I have a Fuji and a Sony and I forgot what else I have. And then I've been using, the iPhone. I mean, I really like the iPhone. And you can do the iPhone RAW file, and I've been using, it's great. I don't have to think about anything, and I can just get into what's going on and the content, and that's always been the most important thing to me. I use it almost like a Polaroid, the iPhone. I go in and just, look at, I can walk through a place really fast and shoot with it, but I'm not, if someone comes up to me and starts talking cameras or something, I just I gotta run away, because it's just not the most important thing, especially, it doesn't matter what you use, it's really how you see.
The second question was your favorite photo.
Oh yeah,
and why?
It's been a while since I've been in front of people being asked that question. I used to answer, and maybe it still is true, because my favorite photography is still my family photography. And I have one of my daughters here today, and I have my niece and my sister, and they are my favorite photographs, by my family. At a certain point, my older daughter, Sarah, said, I don't really want these photographs of us going out there, because I did this book called Photographer's Life, which really had them everywhere. And I totally got it, and I respected that. And I've never really published a picture of them without their permission, at this point. But I still continue with the iPhone. I take pictures. There's, I love still photographing my family more than anything. But they're kind of like, oh God,
Yeah, I think there's.
We have to get drinks,
We have to get drinks. We have to get drinks. Maybe two more questions.
Okay. Are we okay. good? Are we good? Yeah. Okay. Yes, I guess. Yes. Yeah. You're doing it.
It's okay. We'll just wait until the microphone gets over.
Hi, Annie. It's an honor to be in your presence. I'm also a photographer, have been for a long time, and you mentioned that in your early years you were working as a photojournalist and that you had the realization that you were a portrait photographer and a storyteller. And I know from personal experience that I am often very affected by my subjects' stories when I photograph them in a conceptual way. And I just wondered if you could tell us about someone that you photographed whose story personally affected you and gave you an opportunity to personally develop yourself.
I started this by saying no curveballs, okay? And that was an exceptional question.
Why do I immediately go to the Rolling Stone tour? I don't know.
That's a great story if you want to tell that one though. That's even if that's just a bonus, the Rolling Stones.
I really feel like I'm pretty much affected every time I walk in and meet someone. You're walking into someone's life. And then I'm more aware than ever, the power of how I'm going to, see them, and what will go out to the world. When I photographed Brittany Griner, and her wife, Sherelle, I walked in and they had just moved into this new house and it was kind of amazing. There was a mantle, a fireplace mantle, that was where she could just stand at it and it was like up to there, And I had to sort of I knew that I wanted to photograph the humanity in her. I use that. Sounds like I'm using that word a lot, but I had to control myself from asking her to not stand against, and photograph her, because it was amazing. I mean, it was like the mantle was. It just. I don't know what I'm saying. because you want a specific story, or something.
That's great. Maybe.
You were talking about when Daniel Ellsberg was running around trying to chase me, or that. No, sorry. Okay.
I love the Rolling Stone story.
Rolling Stone story.
Yeah, and.
Okay, what is that story?
Well, just to say.
I think up. I use the Rolling Stones as a place in the work where. Up until that point, which is 1975, I really thought you should become one with whatever, you should go in and really, kind of come up, be more, at one with You know, like I would have gone in and started playing basketball with Brittany, you know, Griner or something, you know. Just kidding. Okay. So, but that kind of idea where I, you know, was, you know, tried to be one with it, with whatever the subject. So anyway, when I was asked by Mick Jagger to do the Rolling Stone tour in 1975, you know, I sort of joined this band of men on the road, and you know, and I ended up, I was supposed to be doing pictures that were going to go out to the world, and nothing ever got out, and I ended up being, you know, nocturnal and pretty much up at night, you know, the entire time. And I shot so much film. I mean, I think the camera really protected me, and you know, I always know I'm there as a photographer. But I, you know, it took me like 8 years to get off the tour. You know, I was still on the tour. My friends would say, "You're still on the tour." So you know, it was very. Even when I look back, it was very scary because you know I really always felt I was a pretty strong person and could venture into a lot of things and pull myself out. And it was a lifestyle that, you know, it wasn't their fault, it was mine, you know, because I just kind of went along with it and thought it was cool. But it was, you know, downright stupid, you know. you know, so, is that the story?
Yeah, that's the story. That's great. Okay, so I think we can do one more question, and then we'll go get drinks.
Okay.
Cool? Okay. Where's our microphone floating around? Right there.
Okay, so to end it, who was the most difficult, frustrating person you've ever photographed?
I do like to say that it's never the person, it's really like the circumstances of like you only have an hour or you have a half hour or you were hoping that it'd be overcast so you could shoot properly and it's you know, it's sunny, bright sunny, the worst light you could possibly have. It's more like the circumstances make it really, really, really difficult and hard. You know, rather than anything else. I have, you know, I do, when I think back at some people, you know, who was really difficult. It doesn't really feel like, I kind of understand it. I mean, I don't know any, does anyone really like to have their picture taken? I mean, you know, because you're going into a very psychological situation where the person has to sort of, I mean, I'm not hiding behind a building, you know, shooting with a long lens or something. This is right there. And the person has to, my subject has to sort of come to terms with who they are. And they all, you know, they all deal with it differently. And I totally get it. You know, I do get it, you know. You know, Michael Heiser was extremely difficult. Extremely difficult. But he, you know, he's dying. You know, he really is dying and he's in a lot of pain. And, you know, I admire him so much. And, you know, he didn't really, and I get it. He didn't want to sit still. And, you know, now I just got asked out to lunch, I think, with him. But you know, but we went, you know, it was tough for him. It was tough. Just as an example. But I sort of understand. So I guess I don't like that question. <You know? laughs> It's part of what I do, you know.
Well,
so,
well, thank you for...
Is that a good, bad one to end on?
No. Do you want to do one more? One more just to...
Okay. I don't... It's fine. It's a good question. It's a very good question.
It's a good question, and you were very diplomatic.
When I look back at the most difficult ones, there was something going on within the person's life that was extremely difficult.
We have one all the way in the back.
Okay.
Oh,
Annie, how did you find the transition between film and digital? And do you ever still shoot film?
That's a good question. Over my life, I remember in 1978 when Kodachrome was discontinued, and you know, all my photographer friends like went out and bought boxes of it and put it in the refrigerator and you know, trying to hold on to it. And I think I learned kind of early on, you know, just move on. And you know, I switched to digital pretty fast when it came out. It seemed like too exciting. You know, it was like you could shoot in a situation that there was no light. You know, you could, you were seeing things you weren't seeing before, and the speed of it was kind of incredible, and it was definitely a learning curve. But I really believe strongly in just moving on. I had to learn about it like everyone else did.
Well, thank you, Annie, for the conversation. Yes.